evening. I'm Linda Bell, Provost and Dean of the Faculty. And on behalf of Barnard College, I'm pleased to welcome you to this, our second year of this wonderful series comprised of cross-disciplinary conversations that bring out the beauty of the liberal arts. Tonight, we'll analyze the ways in which we make choices as human beings, both rational and irrational, and how these choices impact our individual and our collective good. We're joined this evening by Joshua New, Assistant Professor of Psychology, and by Homa Zarghamee, Assistant Professor of Economics. Professor New's background is in evolutionary psychology. His studies focus on how our inner experiences are constructions of psychological processes uniquely tailored over evolutionary time to meet the needs of our species. Homa Zarghamee works in the field of happiness economics, among other areas, studying how satisfaction relates to work and to wealth. It's an increasingly popular topic in the press and also among social scientists. Although they work in different disciplines and with very different scientific approaches, they both advance our understanding of the constructs that affect how we experience and how we perceive the world around us. Let me start with you, Professor New. Can you describe for us, please, something about your journey, how you got interested in, and involved in the field of evolutionary cognition?
It's actually almost a lifelong interest. When I was quite young, I just had one classroom where completely at random, the instructor came in and started it by just dragging his nails all the way across the chalkboard across the classroom. He sort of led this sort of discussion about why do people not like that sound and have such a strong visceral response to it. The frequencies that bother us in that sound are the same ones that are in primate alarm calls. I knew I was an animal, but like, that's close, that we're still sort of seeing this in the same ways and responding in the same ways that like chimpanzees and other much, you think, simpler sort of apes are functioning. And then when I got to graduate, undergraduate, I thought, okay, so I'm going to study psychology. It was a class that was taught by John Tooby, who along with his wife and co-author of many articles, Lita Cosmides, is at one of the centermost figures of in the development of evolutionary psychology in its current iteration. And he just laid out the whole sort of, like, this is how evolutionary psychology works. These are the basic premises that we're the products of evolutionary processes, and you can sort of map many of the things that we see and how we feel and think onto sort of the environments in which we adapted in the past. And so that was a lock for me. So I finished undergraduate and then turned around and came back and did graduate school in their lab.
So how does studying cognition from an evolutionary perspective differ from how other disciplines study cognition?
Very differently. So cognition, like the empirical methodologies are very, are just straight off the shelf from visual cognition and straight cognition, but my training was not just in psychology and how to do that properly, but our lab work was also, in our lab and our coursework was also like bioanthropology, hunter-gatherer studies, especially primatology, behavioral ecology, game theory, lots of different studies, all sort of trying to go together to form sort of an idea. A lot of that was all just to try and help us form a composite of what our environment looked like over the last 2 million years, and not including the last 2,000 or so years, because that is kind of like the base model of what we are looking to see. Well, what is the brain evolved to expect that it's going to have to sort of survive in the environment? It's not the modern environment in many ways, because we've only been in this, like our modern environment is just a sliver of time compared to the millions of years that we've been living like sort of semi-nomadic hunter-gatherers.
Homa, yes. How about you? Tell us about your journey to study economics and satisfaction and well-being.
I had no sense that I would be interested in economics at all when I was growing up. And even in college, it was really one of these random, like there was an opening in my schedule and I took it, not quite knowing what it was. and was immediately taken by it. The scope of economics is quite large. So the social issues, macro phenomena that you can study with economics are kind of some of the biggest questions, I feel like, at a social level that we have. The distribution of resources, income inequalities, distribution of wealth. But there's also this micro component that's like individual decision making and a philosophy of individual decision making and a study of individual decision making that felt a lot more like psychology that I had been interested in. And so there was that kind of parallel structure of economics that was very attractive to me. I was really interested again in this articulation of the way that economics describes things and how it can take these really complicated phenomena and simplify them into something that's mathematically expressible. When I got to grad school, I didn't know that psychology and economics were as overlapping as they are. I didn't know that there was a field of behavioral economics until I was in grad school. I got interested in all these different ways in which economic behavior can be influenced by things like emotional filters, by contextual shifts that don't actually change your incentives or shouldn't change that utility maximization problem as far as economists are concerned, but that actually do. And then it was just kind of like a hop and a skip from studying the impact of emotions on economic behavior to looking at subjective well-being or people's reports of their own happiness and reports of their own life satisfaction as an outcome measure itself, something that was worth considering just as much as we consider something like gross domestic product or income as a measure of well-being.
And what are some of the most surprising things you've learned about satisfaction?
One of the first findings from the subjective well-being economics literature spawned a finding that my co-author John Epcher and I had a few decades after the original paper. So even though a country's per capita GDP may be increasing, if you look at the United States from 1950 until now, the per capita GDP is going up. Reported life satisfaction has been a flat line. So then we did a paper where we looked instead of at the average happiness, we looked at the dispersion of happiness, so happiness inequality. How does happiness inequality change as a country develops or when you consider kind of rich versus poor people within a country? And what we found there was pretty interesting that kind of no matter how you cut it, when you're looking at poor people in a country when you're looking at poorer countries as opposed to richer countries, or if you're looking at countries as they develop over time, that economic development was correlated with a compression of happiness, a compression of life satisfaction. Which is interesting also given that economic development tends to be correlated with an increase in economic inequality. So even though you had an increase in economic inequality and you have increased average income, you have a compression of happiness. And that's both that the kind of bottom people are lifted up, the people that are worst off are lifted up and are becoming happier, but interestingly that you have that the happiest people are becoming less happy.
Why is it important to uncover how perception and cognition have been shaped over millions of years?
Evolutionary psychology can provide you some unique sort of predictions. We did this study that just came to be called the Farmers Market Study because we ran it at Santa Barbara has this like a huge farmer's market. It's gorgeous, and it's like a full city block. And then we ran them around these sort of circumscribed routes and had them taste, interestingly, different foods of different qualities at each location. And then at the end, there was a surprise task where we had them go to this compass that I handily created on a tripod, and they could sort of point back into a 360 direction. And we said, okay, well, what we'd like you to do now is point this arrow at each of the directly at each of the foods that you tasted. The really surprising dimension, and it's just so nicely coheres with this optimal foraging idea, is that kilocalories predicted was extraordinarily tight correlation with accuracy. Mm-hmm. So the things like honey and avocado and olive oils like that were just really calorically dense. They were like crazily accurate at pointing. Like with just a few degrees, those weren't obviously novel and kind of unique items, but it actually tracked uniquely down through like potatoes and you know, sort of medium starches, and then down, and then you get to like lettuce, and they're just like, I think it's over there. I don't know. So you can say, well, they tasted it, that somewhere, somehow they were calculating like the nutritional density of this item, and depending on that, it was how much resources they were committing to encoding that particular item. And so that's where you'd say, so people have looked at spatial navigation a lot, but there's, the more you think about it, these are the types of things that people would have to have done like for a couple million years. So maybe we should think that they'd be good at doing it if you give them the right dimensions of task. Interestingly, kilocalories was a strong, strong predictor of their accuracy, but how much they liked each item was not.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, so like, and that's where you kind of can always compare like what an evolutionary prediction is compared to like they learned that what they should like is cucumbers and stuff like that. But it's really not. The brain is actually looking and remembering where all that good stuff is.
Wow.
Yeah.
Very interesting.
So yeah, quite commonly, I think we've been able to generate some pretty novel ideas about even very well-established phenomena.
Great. So I'm going to flip a little bit what you said previously. So you talked about economic development and happiness.
Yes.
What are the consequences of happiness from an economic standpoint?
This is actually one of the early studies that convinced me that maybe we should take these self-reports seriously, even though, again, like economics training doesn't want you to take self-reports seriously. This study by a Harvard and MIT pair of economists, Sendel Melanathan and Jonathan Gruber. According to the neoclassical model, even a decision like becoming addicted to cigarettes is a rational decision. You understand the costs associated with it and you make a kind of free choice to pursue that. The prediction is that, you know, if you're facing a higher cigarette tax as someone who secretly doesn't want to be smoking, wishes they could stop, you would be made happier as opposed to someone who's rationally chosen this. There's a clear prediction from the behavioral model that happiness should go up with cigarette taxes among potential smokers, mm-hmm. whereas it should go down if we believe a rational addiction model. And what they found was, in fact, that the places that have higher cigarette taxes have higher levels of happiness among people who are predicted to be smokers. So I think, in this way, subjective well-being research can fill in some gaps that can't be filled in by the traditional approach. But then I think, again, like these bigger questions, the extent to which we rely right now on gross domestic product as a measure of well-being, I think has been increasingly understood as being wrong-headed, that it is very much a measure of well-being, but it shouldn't be the be-all, end-all.
So a quick question for both of you, and forgive the simplicity of this, but does your research change the way you think of your own happiness or your own satisfaction?
Oh, yeah.
And has your research made you in any way, let's put it this way, affected your perception?
One of the experiences that I've always found the most remarkable is where time seems to slow down. Mm-hmm. A lot of people report it. It can be happened during very dramatic experiences. The predominant idea about time dilation, that's the sort of sense of time slowing down, is that we just form, during these critical events, we form a more intense memory of it. And then when we think about it and we judge how long was that event, we feel like it seemed longer because we can recall it more vividly and more intensely. Mm. But for me and my own experiences and what many athletes report is that when they feel time dilation, it's during critical events in which they are doing something extremely quickly. Like, so if you, like, I think high divers, like you think their whole event lasts about half a second, but they're doing like an enormous number of sort of adjustments during that time. So I think that our time perception is functionally malleable in a way in which you just need to sort of study it in the right way that, that time dilation is not just simply us recalling having been hit by a car really well. Mm. It's that it's in the right circumstances, it's what allowed us to jump out of the way of the car.
Mm. Fascinating.
Oma? The biases that I learned about in behavioral economics definitely made me question everything I was doing. Like, what am I acting rationally right now or irrationally, why am I doing the things I'm doing? And also the just economic model itself that revealed preferences. I never thought of a lot of my own behavior as being indicative of a deep choice, of a deep, like, I prefer to do this, and I am exhibiting that by my choice of, say, product I'm buying or the way I'm spending my time. But it suddenly made me think that way, and it was actually a weirdly empowering feeling.
What do you most want people to take away from your research?
These fields of economics and psychology that might seem really distinct to people and might seem like they are coming at decision-making from totally different perspectives have a lot to teach each other, I guess, that they are very closely related, and that one can, you know, an economist can learn a great deal from psychology. I hope psychologists can learn from economists. I don't know, but I know as an economist that there's a lot to be learned from psychology, and I think also from like other social sciences as well. I assume from other social sciences as well, and it's something that that is increasingly happening in economics. But I think the takeaway is interdisciplinarity, the importance of interdisciplinarity. Yeah.
How about you, Josh?
There's a ton of work being done that we're sort of blind to. Prioritizing various events for awareness, and then other things that are not important to us, we never look at them, we never really think about them, and then they're gone in the world. So there's this enormous sieving of filtering for salient and important events, either whether it's important to us right now or whether because it was important to us as a species over time. Mm-hmm. Yeah. We are processing everything, but only retaining just the barest minimum that is important to us from moment to moment.
Thank you again, everybody, and have a wonderful evening.